she was kept in the detention around 7 hours, and definitely difficult to say how she was treated, but she experienced definitely pressure and probably blackmailing, and spoke under duress, as it was rightly noticed, and all this tape was recorded. So we shouldn't take it for granted, that's for sure. And now she's still recovering after the stress, and she should take time until she will be able and willing to speak. And I spoke to her today. She's, as I said, in good spirit, but I hope let her say herself what she's going to do, what are her intentions and plans. And we should understand that she really experienced a lot of challenges lately.
Minister, you did mention the word blackmailing there in terms of her departure. What do you know in terms of that?
I'm making assumptions, you know. I cannot provide you more details for the moment, but I feel that she really feels quite vulnerable. And we should understand her husband is in custody. And how he is treated, we also can make some assumptions. Definitely, the situation is very tense, as overall abuse, violence, and all these actions are continued. So it's very lamentable and unfortunately not stopping yet.
Not stopping yet. And the president of Lithuania has called for an urgent de-escalation and the release of all detainees. Now, the Belarusian president, Alexander Lukashenko, shows absolutely no signs of backing down. So tell me, what is the plan that Lithuania is trying to organise here?
Not just Lithuania. You know, we nationally always were active. It's our neighbour. We are not indifferent. We're not interfering in domestic affairs, but we are not staying aside and just observing what is happening, because we believe that we need not just stable neighborhood, but also progressive. And we valued this beginning of the dialogue with Western countries, especially the European Union. We always expecting something to be improved, but now last events definitely smashed and destroyed everything. And that means that we have to provide with this kind of clear, consolidated European position. That's much more important than national position. And we have to take it very seriously. So when we're saying that relations must be corrected, reviewed, and there should be political consequences, we have to act accordingly. And what kind of leverages could be? All options should be on the table, including possible sanctions, I believe.
Okay, possible sanctions. Now, obviously, for sanctions to take place in terms of the EU, all 27 states do need to agree. But Belarus has faced sanctions before. Why do you think things would be different this time?
No, it was not different. And there are still opinions that they were lifted, these sanctions. It was unnecessary to do. I believe that it was important, because we definitely had some glimpse of hope when they released political prisoners. We need some incentives, some encouragement to continue in the way of improvement, and it should be done. So we always have a will, but so far we see no signals, no symptoms about improvement. It looks like current authorities, they feel that they have a mandate to act like this, abusing people, using this unnecessary power. I'm saying unnecessary because these people definitely are not really peaceful. They are not smashing windows, they're not burning cars, and they really deserve to better attention. The citizens of the country deserve to be listened, to have a decent dialogue with them, and that least they would like to expect. So we believe we have to say quite clearly on behalf of European Union what is tolerated, what is not tolerated, and at least what could be the other option? To do nothing is not the option.
OK, to do nothing is not the option, and Lithuania has also offered to mediate between the opposition and the government in Belarus. Now tell me, are you in contact with Alexander Lukashenko? Are you in contact with those opposition parties, and how do you see those mediation efforts actually going forward?
I would add condition, but mediation efforts could be important and helpful if we will see added value. You should know between whom you should mediate, basically, and that's a question. So when situation, if situation allows, when opportunity will be for possible mediation, we definitely are ready to do that for the sake to stop this violence, first of all. But you mentioned opposition, so we have to understand that this is quite a chaotic process. It's decentralized, very difficult to follow who is in lead, and even Sviatlana, who is now in Lithuania, she became leader of opposition, but she was never a politician, basically. Let's assume she was just a young woman and accidentally appeared on this wave of popularity and enormous pressure and weight now on her shoulders. She really feels not very good. So let's understand, maybe we shouldn't expect too much from her. So let's see if it will be possible. We definitely will do the utmost to help, to try to find some understanding and to start political dialogue, but to stop violence, first of all, and brutality, which is still going on, unfortunately.
So, Minister, you, as you say, the opposition is in chaos at the moment. But tell me, are you in contact with the Belarusian president? Is there a contact form there in terms for that dialogue to begin?
No, we're not in contact with the Belarusian president. We are from time to time in contact with presidents of government. I talked to my colleague on the eve of elections last time. Was given assurances that it's not in the interests of government to use excessive force, and they are not going to do that. They will act legally, but unfortunately we haven't seen that happening in reality. So we will see how it will be developing, and I believe only clear and consistent message could make a try, at least, to influence the situation. Another statement of deep concern will not help.
Okay, and just, I absolutely, but just, and very briefly now, but given what you are seeing now in Belarus, how concerned are you that this situation risks really spiraling into a bloodbath?
It could be. It's not excluded. And we can see that this is, as I said, this violence spread without any reason. And sometimes people being detained, accidental people have even some of them have nothing to do with what is happening. So we see quite, so to say, messy process, at the same time quite dangerous. And if it will be continued like this, I'm afraid that bloodshed also would not be excluded, which is not helpful to anyone. And I believe neither stability in the country and neither outcome of the situation, getting out of the stalemate situation, it will not help. So nobody will have some profits, except maybe somebody outside the country, but definitely not Belarusians.